Our call to worship for this morning is from Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 20. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before him.
There's a mountain here before me, and I'm gonna climb it with strength not my own. He's gonna lead me where the mountain meets me, carry me through.
Isaiah chapter 52, verse 5 says, "How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who publishes peace, who brings good news to the happenings of the people's salvation, and who says to Zion, your God reigns."
No restless heart do not grow. I waited in the power of God's own.
Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17 says, "The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save." Amen.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. And everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains.
Let us bow in silence and prepare our hearts for worship as we prepare to confess our sin. Let us confess our sin. Almighty and everlasting God, we bow before you in repentance for our sins. We have sinned against you in many ways, most of which are unknown even to us. Forgive us for bad attitudes that offend you, for remarks that hurt you and others, for not following your word and spirit as they try to lead us. Forgive us for those times when we have forgotten to call upon you, and help us to live our lives in the way that will please you. This we pray, thanking you for your great love for us in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Declaration of Grace is from Romans chapter 6, verses 22 and 23. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the fruit you get leads to sanctification and its end, eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Service continues with our scripture readings.
Good morning. Our first reading this morning is from Acts 5, 29 through 42. But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised Jesus, whom you killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior, to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." When they heard this, they were enraged and wanted to kill them. But a Pharisee in the council named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, held in honor by all the people, stood up and gave orders to put the men outside for a little while. And he said to them, "Men of Israel, take care what you are about to do with these men. For before these days, Thaddeus rose up, claiming to be somebody, and a number of men, about 400, joined him. He was killed, and all who followed him were dispersed and came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean rose up in the days of the census and drew away some of the people after him. He too perished, and all who followed him were scattered. So in the present case, I tell you, keep away from these men and let them alone. For if this plan or this undertaking is of man, it will fail. But if it is of God, you will not be able to overthrow them. You might even be found opposing God." So they took his advice, and when they had called in the apostles, they beat them and charged them not to speak in the name of Jesus, and let them go. Then they left the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. And every day in the temple, and from house to house, they did not cease teaching and preaching that the Christ is Jesus. Our psalm today is Psalm 148. Please respond in the bold print. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded and they were created. And he established them forever and ever. He gave a decree and it shall not pass away. Praise the Lord from the earth, you great sea creatures of all deeps. Fire and hail, snow and mist, stormy wind fulfilling his word. Mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars. Beasts and all livestock, creeping things and flying birds. Kings of the earth and all people, princes and all rulers of the earth, together, old men and children. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His majesty is above earth and heaven. He has raised up a horn for his people, praise for all his saints, for the people of Israel who are near to him. Praise the Lord. The epistle today is 1 Peter 1, 3 through 9. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that it is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Here ends the word.
Gospel lesson today is from the book of John, chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see his hands, the marks of the nails, and the place, and I place my finger into the mark of the nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. And although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put your hands in the place in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "You have believed because you have seen me. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Heavenly Father, your word is truth, and as we hear your word truth proclaimed today, we pray that this truth would fall on our hearts in such a way we would grow closer to you as our God, and that we could grow closer to each other as your people, and that we could share this word, Lord, with the way we live our lives out in the world around us. We pray this in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen. You may be seated. Okay, so we begin here in John chapter 20. This is still the day of the resurrection in John. It's that evening, I should say, the evening of that day, the first day of the week. So on Sunday, again, the resurrection happening on Sunday, Pentecost happening on Sunday, why we worship on Sunday because of all these things that happened. The doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews. And doors being locked, doors is plural there, and it would be common in that area if you had a house, you would have an outer door that would lock up your house, and then in an inner room, you would have locks on some of your inner doors too. And so doors, plural, mean they were afraid. They're afraid, okay? We already have the Jews who were hostile towards Jesus his entire life and going around threatening to put people out of the synagogue, i.e. excommunicate them, i.e. tell them that their salvation has been removed from them. This is a heavy thing that they're pushing. And now the Jews have killed Jesus. They have crucified him. And so not only are they afraid that the Jews are going to excommunicate them, they're afraid that if they continue on teaching what Jesus taught them, the same fate will befall them. They will end up on a cross of their own. Double lock the doors, lock the inner doors. They're afraid. Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." Now, remember, Jesus wasn't in the room, and he came and stood among them. So again, we have an understanding. I mentioned last week, as Jesus rose from the dead, he left the tomb before the stone was rolled away. He left the wrappings of what he was wrapped in the tomb. He left them as he just passed through them. So Jesus, in his godliness, his divine nature, able to show up and move around however he pleases, whether it be through the stone that held the tomb or through the double locked doors to get to the disciples here on the evening of the resurrection. Verse 20. Oh, wait, I missed something. Peace be with you. Jesus' message to his disciples. Peace be with you. And this is going to come up again, but that's an important part of this passage. The message that Jesus is bringing to his disciples, peace be with you. Verse 20, when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. It's like they go from Jesus is dead to having these certain people saw the angels. There was an encounter in Galilee. The news is bustling. Jesus is alive. And here he shows up for his disciples in this locked room. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1 says, "Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen." These disciples have seen. Their faith gets to grow based on evidence from their own sight. Our faith gets to grow based on evidence from our own sight in God's word, right? But it's through the eyewitness accounts of these disciples who saw it firsthand in the room. The disciples had seen. John 20, verse 21, Jesus said to them again, a repeat, and in Greek thought, when you repeat things, it's adding emphasis to them, "Peace be with you." This is a reminder of the assurance that he is giving. Now again, where did we start this day? They're double locked inside a room because they're afraid that the Jews are looking for them, probably at very minimum to excommunicate them from the church, at most to kill them. They're being hunted. Peace be with you. This is a reassurance of a gift of peace which God gives. Peace is the opposite of war. If for all time since Adam and Eve sinned, God and mankind have been at war with each other because of our sin, we've been rebelling against God, that problem has been fixed with the crucifixion of Jesus. It has been bought and paid for, and now peace can reign. Peace can reign in our hearts. What was wronged has been righted. What was wrecked has been restored. Our faith, our hope, our relationship with our God is at peace. Jesus continues, "As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." There's a job to do for the disciples here in this town, in this room. The Father sent Jesus. Jesus sends his disciples. The pastor in me wants to continue that on and say, as we read our Bibles and as we bring this word into our own lives, Does this word of God not send us also into the world? Sometimes, you know, we have to live the word of God out in the world so the world can see the word of God through us. Once in a while, we might even have to use our words, right? Get out there and live the word of God. Verse 22 continues, and when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. And this is an interesting one for me because back in the late 1980s, our family got a satellite TV. And I can remember flipping through the channels on the big dish and finding preachers from all over the place. And it seemed like the more outrageous they got, the more likely you were to see them on the television back then. And there was one guy who would have people come up to the chancel area or his stage where he was, I don't know, I would probably call it performing, and he would blow on them, and he'd go, and then he'd say, "Receive the Holy Spirit," and the person would fall flat over back on their back, and it was a huge production. They'd have smoke and lights and all kinds of things, and people would get pushed up there in wheelchairs, and they'd say, do the same thing, and they would stand up and healed and walk off. And there was, I don't know, it was catching to watch, but there's the back of your mind is saying, this is an act, right? You weren't sure about this. You didn't know what was going on. And I don't want to discredit the possibility that there were miracles, but I also know that they have done different investigations on this, and a lot of those types of things have been proven to be staged. And I don't think that furthers the kingdom of God when we stage things and make it look like God does things that he doesn't. That's my take on that. This, Jesus, the Son of God, the Messiah, the one who died and rose again, to his closest disciples, breathes on them and says, receive the Holy Spirit. To turn this into prescription to say this is something that the church should be doing, I think is outrageous. Because this, nowhere does it say here that as a church we should be doing this. This is a description of a historical event that happened. It was indeed miraculous that Jesus gave this gift of the Holy Spirit in this way. We, through the Bible, have biblical descriptions of how the Holy Spirit is given as a gift. Matthew 28:18 says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 2, verse 38 says, and Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So if somebody tells you in order to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, you need somebody to breathe on you, we have other direct evidence in the Word of God to clarify that through baptism, this gift can indeed be given, especially when we look at Matthew and Acts. Verse 23 continues here. Jesus says, if you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them, and if you withhold from any, it is withheld. Forgiveness of sins is a powerful tool that the church has been given by God. And as we forgive the sins of people, they are to receive that as God's grace, setting them free from the bondage of sin, to recognize that God's forgiveness is a gift for them, not something they can earn, something that has been given and is part of their lives. On the other hand, if you withhold forgiveness, it is withheld. And sometimes when sinners sin, withholding forgiveness is needed to get them to realize the damage that they're doing to their lives, the destruction that they're doing to their faith, and the destruction that they do as they sin, the destruction they do to the faith of the people around them. We can't let sin reign. So when there is repentance, we offer forgiveness. when there is obstinance and pride surrounding sin, it is our job as a church to declare that unrepentant and declare that they are not forgiven. Not an easy thing to do. Psalm 103, verse 12, it says, as far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. This is the blessing that the church wants to be involved in giving out. Micah chapter 7, verse 19, he will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. You will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. I like that one. I like that one. My brother, he worked for the NSA for a year while he was in the Air Force, and he talked about data encryption and how they can keep secrets on computers. And he basically said, if you have a hard drive and you have something on there you don't want anybody to know about, good luck. They can find it. And then he said, your best bet is to, put it through some kind of a metal shredder and then haul it out into the ocean, several miles off the coast, and chuck it overboard and let the salt water at it and hope that nobody scuba dives down there and finds it. So that idea, casting it into the sea to get rid of it, to be gone, to be done with it, that's what God does with your sin for you as he forgives you for your sin. Isaiah 43:25, I am he who blots out your transgression for my own sake, and I will not remember your sins. Blots out your transgressions. Think of that term, blots out. It's not as good as the ocean one, casting something overboard. But, at some point they invented whiteout. And when you made a mistake, you could just, cover it up. It's gone. Then you just write right over the top of it. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18, come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be like wool. I this week, had a little project. For my birthday, I asked my wife for something, and she thought I was crazy. Anyway. I wanted the experience of bringing home a sheep and taking it from a sheep, something that, is an animal, into something that I would eat. I'm sorry if I offend anybody there, but it's food that I wanted to eat. I'm just going to say that. And in that process, I also wanted to keep the skin, the hide, and maybe have something that, a little sheep skin with some wool on it. Maybe the dogs will lay on it. I don't know what was going to happen with it. I just wanted to get that prepared. Well, somewhere in there, all that pretty white wool, do you know what happens in that process? It gets covered in blood, and it's not as pretty anymore, right? Anyway, I learned that you can take a pressure washer to it, and that blood just kind of goes away. It's amazing. And then I think of this, though your sins are like scarlet, they can become like wool, like white. And the cleansing process that God does for us is such a wonderful thing. Verse 24. Now begins the problem of this text, okay? Now Thomas, one of the 12 called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the 12th, Judas Iscariot, is gone. He's already out of the picture. We have 10 locked in a room together and one who is not there. One missed out. Thomas not being in that room tells us a lot about Thomas, doesn't it? All of them have followed Jesus for the last 3 years. All of them know he died. They've been hearing, I don't know if it's all of them yet, but they've been hearing reports of his resurrection, and Thomas is not there. He has rejected the possibility that he would be there. Thomas has rejected the opportunity to be there for any type of a meeting like this. He is in an extreme state of doubt, and I think it wouldn't be so far as to say that his doubt is obstinate to the point of rejection. And in his rejection is shown in the fact that he's not in the room with the other ten. Verse 25. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see his hands and the marks of the nails, and place my fingers into the marks of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." This is his point. Unless I have proof, I will never believe. That verse begins, so the other disciples told him. The Greek, from my understanding here, that word told, it's connected to like testify, to bear witness. It's not just a telling like you're going to tell a story. They are laboring to convince him. It's also legal terms, you know, it's bearing witness. They are bearing witness to him, and he's rejecting their testimony. He's saying, I can't hear it secondhand. There's no way that this person, Thomas, is going to be convinced by anything other than sticking my finger into the holes, my hand into his side. The doubt is real. Doubt for us in 2023 is a real thing. Doubt comes to the Christian. And I think if we ignore that fact and we try to hide doubt, it probably doesn't help us at all. It probably just makes a way for the doubt to be able to grow. But recognizing the fact that we have doubt is indeed more proof for the fact that Christ did live on this world, and this book was indeed written about him, and he did rise from the dead. I think that can help our doubt as we fight doubt and we focus our hearts on faith and growing closer to God. If we hide our doubt, if it grows, if we confess our doubt and realize that it's part of the struggle, then we can grow from our doubt. There's proof and evidence, you know. We have an empty tomb, we have a cross, and we have a Bible. And in that empty tomb and the cross and the Bible, there is a lot of proof and evidence for the Christian. There's also other Christians who recognize and believe and trust in God for their salvation. If we hide our salvation from the world, what happens to Christianity? In seminary, I took an apologetics class, how to argue for the faith. And we went through, it's been a long time, but I want to say there were four main categories of how to argue, and it was like, you could argue in this style, or you can argue in this style, or you can argue in that style, or you can argue in this other style, right? And of all those arguments, the different ways of taking people through the text to show them that Jesus is real and you should accept him into your hearts, we had to learn each one and what each one represented and how to do each one. And then at the end of the class, at the end of the semester, the teacher said, "Now, which one of these do you think statistics have shown is most successful in bringing someone to the Lord?" And, you know, everybody's got their opinions, and you say this one, or that one. And they were all, like, very pointed, use these verses or use those verses and argue this way or be very friendly or whatever. And the teacher crossed them all off the board and said, "None of them." You know what works the best is when you tell your personal story of how Jesus came to you. So if you are in an argument about faith or why the Bible says this versus what some other religion says that, there's probably some good in that. But if you're trying to save souls, the best way, the thing that works, is to share how your soul got saved. People make connection to that. Verse 26. 8 days later, we're on the Monday, the week after, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them, although the doors were locked. We have this repeat, okay? So now the disciples have gathered Thomas in and made Thomas part of this party again. That's I think, important to understand. The group has gone after the individual and brought the individual who doubted back. The doors were locked, and Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Again, post-resurrection appearance, appearing in a room behind locked doors, in an announcement of peace from Jesus. May your wearied soul find rest. The locked doors also reminds us that the fear of the Jews is still there. They're still in hiding. They're still not safe. Okay? And the conversation goes on. Then he said to Thomas, I like this, because Jesus wasn't there when his disciples talked to him, right? Jesus wasn't there when Thomas said, "Unless I put my fingers in there, I'm not going to believe." Jesus just shows up in the room, walks up to Thomas, "Peace be with you. Put your finger here and see my hands. And put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Do not disbelieve, but believe. It was like a YouTube reel, one of these short videos this last week. It was of the Newhart show. You guys, raise your hand if you remember Newhart. Okay. I don't know the show well enough. I was a little bit young. Watched some reruns, right? But he was a counselor of some kind, psychologist, and a lady walks into his office, and she goes, "Now, how does this work?" And he goes, "Well, I charge $5 for the first 5 minutes and $1 a minute afterwards, but don't worry, seldom does anybody make it past 5 minutes. But I do charge the whole $5 for the first 5 minutes. You have to pay that. You can't pay $2 if we only go 2 minutes." And she goes, "Well, that seems reasonable, okay." And she goes, "Do I lay down on the couch?" She goes, "No, you just sit in the chair, you're fine. And just tell me what's wrong." And in the psychologist's office, she starts spewing off a bunch of babble about all of her problems, and she's asking questions about her childhood, and he goes, and she's very scared of small places. I remember that. She was very scared of small places. And he says, "Okay, I've heard enough." And she goes, "Well, then what am I supposed to do?" "Stop it!" But if I do it, and she goes on to all this lengthy string, and he interrupts her again, "Stop it! Just stop it, stop it, stop it," over and over again. And she's, "I don't think I like this kind of counseling very much. Stop it!" Over and over again. And then I'm reading this, and I see Jesus telling Thomas, "Do not disbelieve, but believe. Quit coming up with your excuses as to why you think you should be on a different road or a different path. Quit thinking about the doubts that life throws at you. Just stop it." From the words of Newhart or Jesus to us, don't disbelieve, believe. That's Christ's argument for Thomas, for doubt. Knock it off. I like the simple things. And Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Blessed are you, child of God, sitting in this sanctuary, who have not seen, yet believe." I read Hebrews 11:1 a little bit ago. "Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen." You have this gift of faith that has been given by God, and it is been reassured and instilled in you through his word and the proclamation of his word, don't hide it. Don't hide it. Share it with the world around you. Now, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. The purpose of the entire book of John, you could argue the entire Bible's intent, the purpose behind it, is given in this verse. That you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. The evidence is before you. Open your heart, open your eyes, open your mind, receive God's word. Or you could go the other way and choose to be obstinate and reject it for the rest of your life and suffer the dire, dire consequences. Go the way of Judas. Go where Thomas was surely heading. Let's not do that. Stop it. Come to God. Celebrate the gift of salvation that he has given us at the great cost of the cross, but gives us freely. Let's celebrate that gift and remember that as we go out into the world and share that gift with the world. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this day, for our opportunity to hear your word. May this hearing of your word not be in vain. May we allow your word to build up our faith and make our faith grow, and may we not hide our faith from the world around us. We pray this in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Let us sing together hymn number 578, Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.